My name is Francis Whitebird. My Lakota name is Shumhintroagli. I grew up in a household where everybody was a veteran. So naturally, when the time came, I had to test myself to see if I could go into combat and survive. And I did. War is about killing, and war is about winning. You don't go to war to die. You don't say, I'm going to war and I'm going to go to die. You don't say that, I'm going to go to war and kick some butt and come back. I mean, that's the kind of attitude that they taught us in basic training. I didn't mind basic training because I went to a Catholic school and a government boarding school, so I knew communal life, and I could, especially Catholic school, they were a little more strict and lots of discipline, so getting yelled at and as long as they don't punch me, well, I could do it. And it was not a big deal. This basic training was just getting you in shape, and they're trying to reform your thinking. The more prepared you are, the better trained you are, the better your survival is. Yeah, there are four medics in a company. There are three platoons, and each platoon has a medic, and then there's the company medic, or senior aid man, and that's what I was. I was a platoon medic for 2 months, and then I became a senior medic because of the casualties. When I was a company medic, in the first 9 months, we went through 27 medics. That's how high the casualty rate was for medics. My medics were good. Fear is contagious. In historic times, Lakota men went in a group to fight the enemy. And if you do a cowardly act, they have, when they come back, they have what they call a waktogolaka, which is talk about what you did in that battle. And if you do some cowardly act and somebody sees you, they will tell the people, so you cannot, no matter how scared you are, you have to go in and be daring. And it's not a Lakota trait. It's a trait that some of us have learned through observation or through being told, and with actual experience. Sure, it is dangerous. I mean, I got wounded by an RPG that exploded near me, knocked me off my feet. But when I got wounded, it got me mad. I said, who did that? I'm gonna shoot that sucker. And I carried a .45 and a Car 15. Most people think medics don't carry weapons. I did. And the reason why I did that was I wanted to earn enough eagle feathers for a war bonnet. And I used to go out on ambushes, and they have what they call claymore mines. And it's about 1,000 shotgun pellets that go out, and they kill there's a kill zone. And so they set them up on the ambush site, and I used to go out there, and I'm the guy with what they call the detonators are called clackers. And so I have the clacker, and I watch the guy to give me the single, and I press, and then whatever's in the kill zone, you know, is mine. I've had people die on me. And it's, you have to let go. You have to be able to walk away, because there's more coming. There's more deaths coming. And you have to do, you owe it to them. You train that you owe it to them, that to keep them alive. Do the best you can. You're going to lose some. But I'll tell you what, those ones that you save, I met two guys, one in Florida. Booby trap went off, and a piece of shrapnel and broke his arm. We had 36 casualties. It was a daisy chain. One round went right after another. And I came up on him, and he was holding his arm, so I attached his arm to his body like they taught me. And I gave him a shot of morphine. I said, "Here, this will get you happy in a couple of minutes." I saw him in Florida. He had a terrible scar. He said, "Thanks, Doc." I said, "That meant a lot, that somebody recognized you for doing something." And then there was Marty. It was the same booby trap. Marty was the one who set it off. And he had shrapnel. He must have had 20, 30 pieces of little shrapnel all over his body. And he was hurting. So I rolled him around to see if there's any blood spurting, but he wasn't. So I told Marty, I said, "I'll give you a shot, make you happy, and take the pain off." So I gave him a shot, and when the chopper, when the dust off came, we were loading them up, and Marty looked at me, gave me the peace sign, smiling. You high on morphine. And just smiling, and said, "I'll see you back in the world." And I did see him almost 20 years later. We had a reunion in St. Louis. And he brought his family over. And he told his family what I did. And he said, "Thank you, Doc." He said, "I've been looking all over for you to say thank you." Gave me a hug. And each member of the family gave me a hug. That meant a lot. So there are those times when you help somebody in a time of need, a great stress, you get through it, and somewhere in the future, you know, they come up to say thank you. And that's quite a compliment.